This is how I live. This is what I love. This is all the things that my dreams have been made of.
Welcome to my life. This is what I love. This is what the soundtrack to my life is made of. Music, love, life.
Crystal Jordan, Be Honest, and myself, Mr. Kevin. We are Music, Love, Life. And welcome.
On a somber day, she's giggling at the beginning.
What are you laughing about?
I just don't be ready for the Mr. Kevin thing, but I guess we're locked and loaded. Okay. All right.
What?
I just wasn't ready for it again. I thought it was going to die off. Kind of like how Janet Jackson was like, Miss Jackson, if you're nasty. But she doesn't call herself that every time.
So to start the show, you say that wants to die off?
Don't do that.
Wow.
That's foolishness.
Wow. That's dumb. You're so insensitive.
Wow.
Oh my God. I love your wedding ring. Can I say that?
Sure.
I really love it.
Sure.
What is it made of?
It's silicone, actually.
Really?
Yeah.
That is so cool. It looks so trendy.
It's, you know, the reason why is because I work with my hands a lot. So I don't scratch things up, you know, computer areas and stuff. I work in IT. So it lends that. And it's, you know, you can wear it when you go to the gym.
It's very
lightweight.
I like that. Can I touch it here?
Yeah.
Oh, wow. So this is a great option for men that say they don't like the feel of So this, ladies, I will make sure that Be Honest posts the information on where we can get such a wonderful thing. Because I've heard a lot of men say they don't like the feeling of, you know, jewelry, and they're working out. They have to take it off.
You can't even feel it. It's so light. It's
almost my God,
invisible in weight.
I got the ladies. I got them. When I get married, I'm gonna give him two. Here's one for show, and here's one you slip on when you take it off.
And you said you want a man that works on a car too, so he can work on his car. And isn't it?
Yeah.
What happens is if it gets caught, it'll break before it hurts the brakes their finger.
Oh, that's all. You have just. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you. That's awesome. No, I'm serious. Women out there need to hear this information because there's a lot of married men that are opting not to wear their ring because of issues that we can fix.
It's very dressed down. It's almost like it's so modest.
And I love it.
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness. I know we have a relationship expert that's going to be sharing some things, but we've got to have him back and talk about this. I got to share this information.
Oh, my God.
I am, seriously. Because, I mean, I think that's a big thing. I think we talk about, you know, married guys and how a lot of guys, married guys, are sliding into DMs and inboxes across social media, and a lot of them don't wear a ring.
Well, this is good because since it's silicone, it's like a good break. So like you could, as you're sliding in the DMs, you can just put your hand down and stop perfectly.
I don't have a problem if a married man tries to talk to me as long as he acknowledges that he's married, because then he gives me the opportunity to say no, which I will. Which, if any of you guys are considering that, just know it's going to be a no.
When you say talk, you mean just converse?
Well, flirtatious conversation that could possibly lead to ass. I don't like that.
And you think a silicone ring is going to stop that?
Well, I think a silicone ring will stop the excuses. Because I know a lot of guys give the excuse that they don't like wearing jewelry.
It's uncomfortable.
It's uncomfortable. I got to work out. I take it off.
Yeah, if you give them a silicone ring.
I'm giving them two.
They'll never think of anything else.
I never wear my regular ring to the gym, ever.
Right. I don't want you to lose it. But I do want you to have a reminder.
Yeah, but
this ring,
you don't even notice it's on, so you can wear it.
That's beautiful, women. Mm-hmm. This is so your man can stop with the BS. Be honest, says he can't even feel it. It's like it's not even there, which means your love and the symbol of your love can always be intact.
What are you on tonight?
I'm just saying. I told you before I like it, and I had a chance to touch it and understand the substance. So I think that's awesome. I'm preparing for marriage.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
I don't have a groom yet. But
good to know.
Yeah. That's nice.
That's weird though, right?
What?
Is that not weird how she's preparing for marriage and she doesn't have a groom yet?
Well,
I'm glad she hasn't married Jesus.
But I'm saying the other way around, right? First you find a guy like, you know what?
No, because I didn't want to get married. I was very anti-marriage because I went through a divorce. Mm-hmm. So now I've just recently become open to the idea, but I need to understand what boundaries and, you know, situations I would be okay with marriage. I definitely would not be okay with marrying someone that did not wear their ring.
So this is what Crystal wants, the list.
This is a part of the list, and Crystal wants a man that's, if you're going to ask me to marry you, that means that you're going to wear the ring. So this, I'm going to get that.
Yeah.
And when I go up the altar, I'm going to be like, hey, which one do you want to put on now? Let's just put on the the real one, and then I have the other one in my purse, and we can slip it on later if we go.
Yeah, I still wear my regular wedding ring when we go out on
dates.
That's
what I mean. At the wedding, but I just want him to know I have it, you know, so in case later if we go swimming or something, I don't want him to worry about it. I got you right here. Slide this one on, and we're good.
Yeah, cool.
I would like two rings also. Maybe that's three.
We have three.
Because then I get an engagement ring, which should be really big, and then a wedding ring, which would be sparkly but not as big, and then a dummy ring.
Dominique, though, right? Not diamond, right? Dominique.
Which one?
The lab created diamonds.
Which one is that?
Dominique.
Which one is that?
For all of them.
The fake, no.
Yeah, because oh, you don't, you,
no,
you
for
like.
The fake one, yes. Not for the other. That's my point. That's what
so
I'm saying.
So you got to have one that's authentic.
I need two.
Two that are authentic?
Yes, two.
Kids are dying. Arms get chopped off.
No, they don't. I don't believe that. I think that's a dirty lie. I believe I need three. I need
Hotep, little kids are getting hurt, right? Maimed.
She doesn't want to believe the truth.
He's not a Hotep when it comes to this. Hey, how about this? Are you gonna buy a real diamond for your intended?
No.
He's lying.
You saw him look.
I know.
He tried to figure out what was the best
way to answer this episode. Is she listening in?
Because you know you'd be having to hear that shit later, right?
Right.
I got you, girl. I got you, girl. He gonna get you a real diamond.
We should all commit to buying Dominique from now on, or whatever it's called.
I'm not committing. Now, I will on the third one.
God. So, $9,000 later, $10,000 later, we can get you know what I'm saying? Those are still pretty expensive, I think.
You think?
The lab-created ones, I think they're still pretty expensive.
I don't care what they are. That's my
dummy. You tried to convince me to spend three years worth of my salary?
No, it was six months. It was 6 months.
She tried. I was like, Crystal.
It was 6 months.
And I was going to say 3 months, but six?
Kevin, you're going to do it. Mr. Kevin.
6 months.
You're going to spend it.
6 months.
You're going to, I bet you will.
Yeah,
I bet you won't.
I bet, let audience.
6 months.
Let's watch and
he's
see.
He's on camera. He's on.
I know.
He's on recording.
I know.
He's on
I know.
Camera.
It was a setup anyway, and I took it because I shouldn't even answer the question.
Right.
He's trying to back pedal.
It was a setup.
Yeah, she got you.
Mm-hmm. I got
look,
you.
Look how much joy she has in it. Look. She kicked her head back, closed her eyes. She was filled with glee.
Right.
Women are evil, man.
How is that evil? Because I want you to make her happy.
Mm-hmm.
Happiness
how do you,
is
how
key.
Do you know? Did she tell you that's what she wants?
I bet
that's
you
what
is.
Makes her happy.
Would you like to call her on? Would you like to
maybe
call her?
Maybe her happiness doesn't reside in material
Can
things.
Can we call her on the speaker? Come
on. The show.
I have her number.
Call her.
No. He's
call her.
He's making a mistake right now. Do not call her. You got to under.
I'm going to go with it if that's what he wants to do.
We don't want to do that. Oh, God.
This is my phone like this.
This can't go good. This can't go well from this point.
Are we ready? Shall we? You're looking like
stone. I didn't say a word.
Hey, man.
Actually, what I said was call her.
I'm a content creator, so I don't want to stop a train wreck.
He said call. Do you want me to call?
Do you want to call?
You don't want to play that game. You don't want to play that game.
Be mad at me.
Wow.
I would never say call. I'd be like,
no.
I would be like, no.
I can't control the outcome of this.
Ain't that what do?
I have to have a prep.
Ain't
first.
That what women do most times? They just tell you nothing's wrong when something's definitely wrong.
Yeah, but what's that to do with anything?
They
but
say I go don't. Do you, and they mean don't do
but
you.
But I mean that's in a relation, in a romantic relationship. But I've learned to stop doing that. But I don't. I won't
no,
do
ain't.
That because I think that you're going forward, and I don't think you want to do that. So I'm gonna be a friend. I'm gonna be a friend and pull
just,
back.
Just blind courage.
That would have been funny.
It's all that kale juice. He's drinking it fast
he
now.
Is,
he sped
is.
Up his frequency.
He did. He
at
was
first, he was
like,
taking slow sips.
I said, you want me to call?
He's like,
do you want to call? Like, nigga, I want to call.
Go on. No, hey, if you really want,
I love content. I love content.
You've been getting your fill lately.
I'm fighting the urge to go ahead and push that button for you, but so.
I'm just saying, I'm not going to do that because I know if I was on the other side of that and someone called me and my guy was there, I would have been like, of course I want a diamond. Like, Why right. wouldn't you buy me a diamond? You're not gonna buy me a diamond. Like, you're sitting up there, and I'd be, and then I would just
you
get
tell
quiet.
All these people that you,
and then I would just get quiet, and then I'd wait till he got home. I don't want to do that to you.
Yeah,
mm.
All right. We like
well,
your stuff.
I'm
in the
a
closet.
Little more secure in my relationship that you know, because sometimes when you're in a relationship, everybody doesn't like it, and then there are some people that may do some messy things here or there. Relationship has to sustain that.
So you were testing Crystal just then?
No, I wasn't testing Crystal. But oh. Hey, I'm not the only or the first one to be in a relationship. So, you know, these things have happened before.
I ain't gonna lie. I wouldn't even say call none of my exes.
Me either.
Nope. Neither.
I don't, because I don't know
don't
what
call.
Their intentions may be. Whether or not they're telling the truth or not, doesn't
well, we ain't talking
irrelevant.
About exes. We just, you talking well, about honestly, current.
I mean, if I was, when I was in my current relationship, I wouldn't have done that. I'd have been like, ooh, I don't know what mood that nigger's in. I don't know what's going to be going on at the house. I don't,
right.
They want to hold off on that one. He asked to come up here a couple times. I was like, let's just hold off on that.
Mm.
Yeah. That was good thinking. See? Mm. That was good thinking.
I would have had some great questions, though. It would have been great content.
Well, I averted that.
Not too late.
You got to protect your relationship, man.
Well, you know.
Protect your happy.
You try. You try. I think there's a difference between men and women. I think men and women are just, we're very different. I think that's what I learned the older I get, that we are just really at different.
What do you mean by different?
Logical and illogical, I think is what you mean.
That's not what I meant.
That's not what you meant?
No, of course not. No, might be like normal and asshole. Like,
factual I think and
okay,
emotional.
Can we agree that all men have an asshole factor in them? And that's not hard. That's not a far. That's not a far jump.
I don't feel like. I don't feel like every guy is an asshole.
Give me a percentage. I didn't say an asshole. I said it has an asshole.
Well, everybody has an asshole in them.
Really?
Yeah,
I know lots of women that don't.
What?
I don't know. How can we prove or disprove this? I don't know the way to make this metric make sense. So I don't know. I feel like I'm an asshole.
That's the first step.
Yeah, I mean, I
do
can.
Do you feel like there are a lot of guys that are like you?
Yeah, I mean, you know.
There we go. There it is right there. We're pulling the pencil through those dots. We're connecting them right now.
When it comes to being that, it's, you know.
Okay, so what we have right here, ladies
and gentlemen.
Usually
better.
Be honest has just admitted that he is an asshole and that there are a lot of men that are like him, i.e. a lot of men are an asshole. Okay, ask me.
Do you think I'm an asshole?
No, ask me, am I an asshole?
Okay. This is so fun. I don't know why. Right. This is so fun there. Are you an asshole, Crystal?
Absolutely not.
Okay.
Never.
I don't know what we do next.
So the next question is, are there a lot of women like you?
Are there a lot of women like you?
Absolutely. So, i.e., there are a lot of women that are not assholes and a lot of men that are.
I don't know what the next question is.
It's just very simple. We just solved the question.
Is it fun in your world?
Yeah.
Is
What does that mean?
I don't know. You go places and like, I don't know where do you come up with these, like...
Is that not a logical, like, that's a real philosophical, like, equation. Like, is this true? Yes. Is this also true? Then could we conclude this? That's very simple. That's not illogical.
So you're saying, but you're saying that assholes or the quantity of assholes is factored by gender?
Yes, I am.
So I about am. Bitches. Are you a...
I want to do more of this pseudoscience.
That was good.
Are many like you?
That was the next
that
logical
was
step.
That was good. That was good. I give it to you. That was good. The only thing that is throwing a kink in that, I admit, I can be bitchy from time to time. And most women I do know have the same trait.
Most men have that trait.
That's what I was going to say. That's the kink, though, because there are a lot of bitch men, too.
I promise you, and I don't care what anybody says, men, dudes, y'all can get mad at me. When y'all have, like, y'all have a cycle, we have one, too.
I agree.
And it's just we don't bleed because we're, you know, we're better.
It is a bitch-assness.
Because we're better than y'all. But I think that there's a time of the month where we have our moments.
I'm
it's
so
like,
glad you
what
admitted
is wrong
that.
With me?
That is so going to be.
He's in the bathroom. He's like, what's wrong with me?
I'm so glad that you were strong enough to admit that.
It happens.
Good for you.
I've caught myself a couple of times. Like what
why am I being a bitch?
Yeah, like, why am I being such a bitch about this? Yeah. I've said that before.
Yeah, I have too, a lot of times. I'll feel it. I'll be like, uh-oh.
You feel it, company?
I feel myself doing it, and I feel the other person having to deal with it. I'm like, this isn't fair to them. This isn't fair to them.
That's what Thriller, that's how Thriller started out. You remember in the beginning? She said, you okay? Just, rah, go on.
Right.
Yeah. You get there. Yeah. You feel it coming?
I'm so happy that you admitted that, because I literally, and can we also say that guys are also emotional?
Yeah.
Very emotional. Because, oh, you guys are emotional. We're logical.
We're also
y'all
human.
It's a lot emotional.
We're human.
Hell.
It's a lot of dudes been crying this week.
Yeah, well,
online, not just Kevin. Now we know, we all know, because we're good friends with Kevin.
Well, it has nothing to do with us being good friends. If you're a Facebook,
follower,
you have a Facebook friend who's friends with Kevin.
You've seen crocodile tears.
You've seen him outside cry of the outside
ranch.
A shed.
Oh, it was a shed. Where
it was
a ranch.
It was a garden shed.
Where was he at? Like in the country somewhere,
in his
right?
backyard. But I think he has like a shed back there.
And what was he was crying because of the guy who
it
raped the girl
movie.
And then woke up the next day.
No, it was a movie. Was it the Django?
No, wasn't it the guy who raped the girl and then they woke up the next day and had
movie.
Sex again?
It was a black movie.
And she,
it was a black movie.
Right,
though.
But it was that guy. The guy in that movie was the guy who raped the girl in college, or he had sex
that
with her.
That was the, yes.
What's his name?
Yes. It was the Nat Turner.
Nat Turner movie.
The mm-hmm. Nat Turner movie.
That
yeah.
movie
what
drove
it
Kevin to
it did.
Pure
it was
emotion.
A very emotional moment outside his home.
A big 6'6" nigga
in
out
another,
in the woods.
In northern Georgia.
In the woods, crying with a pine.
I did. The story of Nat Turner
it was in a
brought
suburb.
Me to
it
tears.
Was in a suburb with a it was a with a lot of greenery.
There wasn't a pine straw in his mouth? I thought I saw like it looked so, it felt so.
It might have been, but I'm just saying, like, if you had panned wider, you would have seen so trees.
I swear he may look like Nat Turner himself.
So you spend a lot of time outside with your horses.
I do.
But I can't be in my backyard.
You can. I know it's nothing
no,
wrong
no,
with that.
No, because you dress it up like I'm super in the country. And
no,
like
I said you were in a suburb.
I'm chewing straw.
It was the angle. He had the
it
angle
was the
below
angle.
Facing straight up so he couldn't see buildings.
And it was by the shed and you yep. would think that it was like a shed with horses, but it wasn't. It was probably a shed with like computer equipment or
probably,
something.
Probably something like
that. Yeah,
but it
very
like
suburb.
It
was very suburb. It's a very suburban
area. I thought you were on the set of the movie.
I don't know what was going to happen.
His tears
like,
felt real, though. They were a little uncomfortable, though.
It was uncomfortable.
It was too much, right?
I was uncomfortable. And like, then I was like,
turn the faucet off a little bit. Just turn it down a little bit.
I was like, what did he... Did he?
So you trying to say Hotep shouldn't have feelings?
No, what I'm wondering is that, okay, did you have a selfie stick?
Do you see how many people were...
Wait a minute.
Did you see how many people have been mourning?
No, but that's different. Okay, hold on. Before we go there, we got to finish this up. Because I was trying to figure out how you got the angle to be... Because you can't be crying and holding the phone. Did you have a selfie stick so that you could get that? Because we saw your
face.
It was
a very odd angle.
It was. Well, I'm just asking. I have a selfie stick. That does enable you to show your face and some of your body without holding it. Because if you were holding the phone and crying... That's awkward.
His arms are pretty fucking long, though.
Maybe your arms
his
are
arm
like
is
a selfie
stick.
Right? I'm just wondering. Or was it
are
propped?
You done? Are you
was
done
it,
now?
Are you done?
How many, is there something
was it
else you have to get
no,
out?
Here's the question.
Was it propped?
How many takes did you do? Because that cry. He was like, damn, I got to cry again. He's trying to drink water to get more tears in his ducts and shit.
I got to start this over again. Hold on.
Like I'd be one. Oh.
Hold on. Let me. Okay.
I don't know. I think the problem was I didn't feel like what he was crying about, what he was saying was emotional enough to cry about. And I think that's what it was.
How long since you had turned the movie off? Did the movie go off and you right away went outside and started crying? Or did you come home from the movie? These are questions that I've always wanted to ask. Like, did you pull up in your driveway, drive home, pull up in the driveway?
He was crying hard.
I just saw the movie. Man, black people don't love each other.
And we don't.
We don't.
And we don't.
Did you watch the movie in the house or did you go to the theater? Because in the theater, I left. I'm not going to lie. I didn't finish the movie. I left.
Really?
No. I can't take stuff like that.
No, Crystal likes whites.
Oh,
Retaliation. Oh,
I said it before. She likes the whites.
That's
you know,
not true.
Anything that faces too much truth, she gets a little flustered.
That is
about.
Not why I did not watch movies.
It is true. That's you do get, don't be hurt. You get flustered. What's wrong with
flustered.
Having emotions? You're a woman.
I didn't get
have emotions.
I didn't get flustered. I just don't like to watch. We know what happened. There's no need to watch it over and over and over and over again. Like,
what do you mean? It came out in the theaters.
I didn't. And
you, when you
I
paid
did not
for your
ticket,
you
I didn't pay for a ticket. No. I went to a premiere.
Oh, okay.
I was invited to a premiere, and I went, and there
so,
was a
so
scene.
You were invited, and you wouldn't even watch for free?
No, no, because you know what? My peace of mind is way more important than free.
Peace of mind.
Yeah, my peace of mind.
Peace of mind.
Please stop. You're
oh, so you like
up.
To
oh,
stay? No, you like to stay in a happy place. You don't want to be.
No, I'm
you
aware.
Want to believe your lies.
So, it's not, what lie am I believing?
You
want to
believe your lies.
What
you
lie
want to
am
stay
believing?
In your happy. Oh, I think I know,
what
but
lie?
I don't know. Really? I just think I know.
What are you talking about?
I don't
about?
Know, but I just think I know. And I like believing what I know.
Real eyes, real eyes, real lies.
Ooh. Shut up. That's deep.
I don't know what he's saying. I don't okay. understand it. So I'm going to leave it alone.
Cognitive dissonance.
Everybody,
there it is.
Everybody does
we block
that.
It out.
Everybody does
That's
that.
That's why she didn't want to watch the movie, because she blocked it out.
I felt equally as... I felt more connected to your Facebook cry than I did the movie. It was powerful.
Okay.
And funny. And powerful. I could tell it
it's
was,
like, this is why, like, when they tell you when, especially we're in entertainment. So if you put out a video, never read the comments.
Right.
Never right. read the comments.
But that's not entertainment.
I don't
that's
think in your I don't think they were trashing you in your comments, honestly. I don't think they did. I was
no,
just
no.
I just text
and
Crystal.
That's just Facebook.
We were trashing you in our text message.
You always mess with me about that.
It was
us,
funny.
Whatever.
It was a funny thing.
It was just unexpected.
But I do understand. I mean, it was a very sad movie, but I think that everybody is different. Just like, you know, obviously we have to talk about the murder of Nipsey Hussle. I did not choose to watch the video. Like, I had people sending me the video. I don't want to watch a person get killed. I don't. Do I know that he's dead? Yes. Do I know that... I already knew it was one of us that did it, because I did two events with him last year, and there was so much police protection because of his gang involvement. And not that he was doing anything, you know, negative, but they just were wanted to be prepared. So... And I know a little bit of the, you know, of his backstory. So I knew it definitely was one of us. But just because I don't want to watch something doesn't mean that I'm uninformed. I just don't choose to put those images in my head.
Yeah, I didn't want to see
and,
it either.
And watching, and that movie was, and some people like really gruesome stuff. So if I got killed when I leave here and in a really bad car accident, I doubt that either one of you guys would want to watch that over and over again. If there was a movie reenactment of it, I hope that y'all wouldn't be like, ooh, let me watch. I mean, that's difficult to watch. Some people are more sensitive. I can admit I'm very sensitive. So I did not want to see. I watched the Nat Turner story until there was a scene where there was a slave master removing the teeth of the slave.
Oh,
and
yeah.
I left.
That was a difficult.
I couldn't handle that. So that doesn't mean that I like whites or, well, first of all, I don't.
That may have been the most disturbing part of the movie. It was a very
disturbing scene, and I did need to keep that in my spirit as I left, and I have work to do and things to happen. No disrespect to that. I definitely respect our history, but I'm not a person that likes to live in that pain every day, because if you do, you will not move forward.
It doesn't do you any good.
It doesn't. So in the same way, I didn't want to watch what happened to Nipsey. Am I deeply hurt? Yes. Am I just... confused and saddened, absolutely, but I don't need to watch that. And I don't feel bad for that.
I do think that Birth of a Nation and the surveillance video of Nipsey being murdered are two very different things. That was a film that told a story and actually included very little violence. Like, even the war that was the climax of the movie, that was the very end.
But that's your... That's
that was like the last
10 subjective.
Minutes out of 2 hours.
I don't know, but Mr. Kevin, that is subjective. and you decided that there's little violence. For me, that is a lot of violence. When I watch somebody pry teeth out of a mouth, that is disgusting, and I don't want to see it. If it was happening right next to me, I would not look. So I don't choose to do that, and I'm not going to feel like I'm not a proud of my race because I don't choose to watch those images. So you can't really shame me into feeling bad about that because that's not going to work. I believe in causes, and I know our history. I'm sure we could go back and forth, but I don't choose to watch certain things. I don't feel like if there's a rape, I don't choose to watch that. That's that because it stays with me. It may not stay with you, and that's awesome. But you know, people are different in how they process things.
Or it may be something that he uses as fuel.
Right. I don't need that fuel. I don't need that.
Or that's just not the fuel that you use.
Yeah, I don't need that particular fuel. Everyone is different. Some people can watch something like that, go home and be depressed and suicidal. That obviously is not you. So that's awesome. I mean, you were on Facebook crying, but somebody else might not have been able to come out of that place. So you just, everything is subjective. And I think, you know, we laugh and joke, but we're all different. And we all have to realize that people process pain differently. People process violence differently. There are some people right now that are dealing with deep depression over what happened to Nipsey. There are some other people that are using this to try to make themselves seem more popular on social media by posting his pictures and saying things, and they have no concern about his life. They're just trying to posture themselves to be more popular. Everybody has a different motive, and you can't say what someone should or should not do because you don't know what their DNA makeup is.
You know what? In response to that, I will say this. That is the part of the game that I don't like. That, I mean, you can, in life, you can be so many things to so many people, but you still have a form of control. Like, you can still choose to do or not do.
Right.
You know, whatever it is that, you know, makes you great and makes people celebrate you.
Mm-hmm.
Right. But once you die, it becomes their choice how they choose to.
Right.
It becomes their choice whether they choose to exploit you.
Yeah.
And do a documentary on you 10 years after you're gone.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Or if they choose to say, hey, we were doing some great things and I just want to show everybody that I met him. Here's my picture. And then and at a certain level, I want to say if there was ever a time to post it or to state your feelings about this person, it's in their passing. That's
right.
That's what you do at a funeral. You know what I mean? Everybody says, hey, I had this experience. This was a great person. It's unfortunate that we lost them.
Yeah.
Right? I wish there was more respect for the dead in a way. Like, there was a video.
Mm-hmm.
Immediately, like, within an hour of me hearing the news that Nipsey had been killed, I received a video in my inbox with someone that was on a live, and they were confessing to having shot Nipsey. And there were people saying that the video was fake and that there was some kid. I want to believe the youth wouldn't do something like that. But that was so quick, so immediate. It was designed to get a reaction.
And obviously it was a lie.
Or maybe I just couldn't help but react.
But that's what he's saying. He wants to believe that the kids wouldn't have taken an opportunity like that to then do something like for clout or for likes or for attention. That just the fact that you would use something like that so blatantly.
I think it desensitizes us, and I think that we are desensitized. I think that we saw this. I mean, you brought up Michael Jackson. That's true. This documentary was put out for money and popularity 10 years after his death.
Oh, you haven't heard the new news.
What?
Oh, the director's having to pull some shit back.
Oh, wow.
Because the biographer called him on some stuff. You read that?
Good.
Yeah, they've
That's
admitted
awesome.
That there were some inaccuracies.
Oh, wow.
Inaccuracies to the
and
part
or
where...
And bold-faced lies.
To where the place where he was saying he got molested wasn't even a place yet. It hadn't been built.
Oh, my God. So why isn't that a headline?
Well, that's how it goes,
God.
Right? We shout what will get people's attention. We make that front page news. It's on the cover of every magazine. But the retractions are always small and in the back.
Quiet, yeah.
But even if it's a lie, I think, you know, Denzel Washington, let's just take a moment to honor him. Denzel Washington said I just want to take a moment.
Okay.
But he was talking about the media, and he was like, the media now are not trying to be truthful. They're trying to be first.
I saw that interview. It was very uncomfortable for that white lady who was interviewing him.
It was. She didn't know. He would not. He just would not make her comfortable.
And he was looking her dead in the eyes. No. He didn't divert his vision, no. his stare.
And he said, you have a very big job in front of you. And she was just like, oh, she's trying to, you know.
Oh, yeah, like, you're right. I know, yeah. Trying to play like you're not hurt. Like, he's fucking with you, and it's working.
Now, I didn't know that about Michael Jackson. That we definitely need to talk about that. But when Kim Porter passed away, I mean, people that probably took a picture with her at a party, all of a sudden, oh, my God, everyone's going through their phones and pulling up pictures and, you know, with Nipsey, like I said, I worked two events with him. I refused. And I saw some of the people that, because I hired some people to work the last event that we did with him at Opera. And I saw a lot of people posting those pictures from that event. And I feel like people are doing that. A lot of people, not all, are doing that to try to prove that they were close to something that's trending. And it's shameful to me.
I like it. I'm gonna tell you why. You want to say something before I say why I like it?
No, go ahead. You first.
I like it because what it does is bring awareness even more so to Nipsey. And what I'm hoping though is that those pictures are followed up by posts about the things that he was doing for the community or things he was doing to
He was
uplift
doing
black
so
people.
Much for the community that it's hard for people to say anything else.
I mean, but I'm gonna be quite honest. Being an East Coast or a Southeast guy, mm-hmm. I really didn't know too much about Nipsey Hussle. Mm-hmm. And I actually got mad at my West Coast counterparts that I do shows with. I'm like, you know, now y'all saying this is the Tupac was supposed to be.
Yeah.
Why didn't you say this 6 months ago? He's been doing all these things for years.
Yeah.
Why did I not know more about him? Because you guys were like, in LA he was huge.
Yeah.
Why weren't y'all making
him huge?
He was
just starting
anywhere?
To be. Like I said, when he came here, I will say this. He did an event at the athlete stores, sports stores in Greenbrier Mall here in Atlanta last summer. And I went to work it, and it was a lot of people there. They had a lot of police protection. I have never seen Greenbrier filled with that many men. It's very strange for men. Usually you see women. He was a good-looking guy. They're women. Usually it's going to be women to come to something like that. It takes a lot to get a grown man to come out to a store.
Respect. That's respect.
In the middle of the day. That's what I was going to say. So what impressed upon me about Nipsey is the level of respect that the community had for him. My godmother told me years ago, you can judge a man's character by how other men respond to him. And all these gang members that look like they don't really frequent the mall came, and he sat there in line. He talked to everyone. He looked them in the eye. He shook their hand. He treated them as though they were all the same. And I'll never forget that. That is probably the one of the few times I've seen a celebrity do that with that type of genuineness. You know, and I didn't make a post about that, but that just resonated with me because I remember thinking, wow, these guys really have, I mean, the entire, you know, southwest side of Atlanta was there, and they were so happy just to see him. They didn't buy me any shoes.
Yeah, well, it wasn't about that.
It wasn't about that, but it was beautiful. It was really beautiful
and
to see.
And at the same time, sadly, that was his undoing.
Yeah, it was. It was.
Him being so accessible was his undoing.
It was. But you know what? Somebody said to me today that obviously he lived a life that, you know, people, that was admirable in many, many ways. I mean, I didn't know all the other things that he was doing. So perhaps his death will incite some people to really carry on that work, perhaps.
Well, I think that's what makes him great, too. I mean, clearly it makes him a target as well, but I think that that's what makes him great is mm-hmm. that, especially in an era where people become famous for doing nothing, mm-hmm. right? They're called celebrities, but they haven't really done anything worth celebrating, right? Whereas Nipsey was involved with his community, he was someone who people should model themselves like.
Right.
Right. He embodied a lot of what he even rapped about in a positive way. And so those people that are feeling sorrow or, you know, offering their testimony and, you know, kind of how they feel about Nipsey. That's genuine stuff. Unfortunately, it does get blended in with all the ones that are trying to make themselves look great and
yeah.
misusing Ipsy.
And I think, I guess I agree with you. Like, I guess in all that BS, if some good comes out of it and someone else is inspired, posture on.
The longer his name is said, the better.
Posture on.
Because somebody's going to get curious. You know what I'm saying? The more times you see that picture.
Or inspired.
If you had no idea who that dude was, you know what I'm saying?
Some young person may be inspired. I feel so bad for his children. You know, see, he took his daughter to the Grammys.
And you know what? And it's funny because y'all even brought up me crying on video, because the emotion that you feel and the, like, his death has not only been about him, it's also been about Dr. Sabi. Mm-hmm. It's also been about Black people and why we keep hurting each other, why we don't value each other, right? It's been about conspiracy theories, right?
Yeah.
It's been a larger conversation that's really, like, my pro-Black ass had me like, yo, I hate niggas. I hate niggas right now.
Yeah, you see the game?
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. It is something to cry about.
And I do have to say this. We were joking with you earlier, but I think it's important to say we're being silly, but we're not being serious, because it is... I think that Black men need to know that there is a safe place for them to show emotions. You know, I mean, it is, we're different in certain things, and we can talk about that, but we definitely have more things that are the same. And I think that I actually was the relationship expert that is going to be, you know, joining us with segments in just a minute. He and I were doing a live the day that it happened, and he was like, hold on, let me get, you know, I just can't, let me get myself together. And I told him, I said, you know what? I think that the fact that he was showing emotion shows strength. And I think that as Black women, we need to say to Black men, it's okay for you. There's a safe place for you to show emotion. We need that, because the hardness, you know, D.L. Hughley was saying all that anger is really just displaced emotion that doesn't have any way to get out. You know, and that causes, you know, when boys are sad, they don't know how to deal with sadness, so they get angry. And I think that if we could start to heal young Black men, if we let them know that there is a way to show their emotion and to get that out. And women obviously have to be a big tool in saying that there's nothing wrong with that. That doesn't make you weak. That doesn't make you a punk. It's not funny. We just, you know, we're having a little bit of fun with Mr. Kevin. But the fact that he was moved, I couldn't watch the movie because it made me so sad and depressed. He obviously had a reaction to it as well. We're not different. It's just how we show it. There were men crying over Nipsey's death. And I think that us saying that is healthy, that is a healthy thing. And we need to make sure that men know that that's okay, that is normal, that it is abnormal not to show emotion when something hurts you.
Well, sometimes you got to cry to keep from beating somebody's ass.
You should, but that's the thing. D.L. Hughley was like, if that man who killed Nipsey, because they have the guy, and there's a horrible story of how Nipsey told the guy he didn't want him to be around him because the guy was doing some things that he didn't agree with, and the guy got so angry and he came back and shot him. He said, if you just hold on and not react in that moment and realize that you are loved, and there's all these different things that these young men aren't feeling. Because it's easy to look at them as monsters and not people. But Nipsey was loved, but that young man that killed him also, you know, is someone's son, probably someone's lover, whatever. We just have to, as a culture, we have to start to embrace and love on men in a way that takes away some of that anger, you know? That's dismal.
Well, I mean, it needs a pause.
Yeah. I mean, it's definitely, it's heavy.
Yeah.
It's not a light, quick, oh, well, that was nice. Moving. It's a lot to deal with. It's a lot to unpack.
It is.
I think that everybody wanted, the reason why there was so much talk about conspiracies and Dr. Sabi and government corruption or whatever, all the things that were being talked about, I think it's because Black people wanted it to be more important. They wanted him to have died for like some type
of cause,
martyr.
Yeah, yeah.
And dying for nigga shit was just...
Awesome. Somebody angry
it's
for a moment.
It's just a
moment.
Waste.
This is a waste of
like, you know, you're saying you feel bad for his kids and his fiance, but everybody out there that I know.
Yeah. I don't think I've been this affected by a death since Tupac. And I think it's because you felt his, you know, he just was somebody that was, he wasn't a loud guy. You know, there's a lot of, he was very quiet, but he was so genuine. And he really was putting, he wasn't the type that wanted to do a big press release or, you know, put out on his Instagram every time he was doing
actions.
Something that was,
he
was
wanted
actions.
To do X.
Mm-hmm. Yes. And that respect, acts that's why all those men were there at that mall. That's why we did something at Opera and it was packed to capacity because he had so much respect. There's no substitute for real shit.
Yeah.
You cannot fake it.
We are our network co-host Baylor the Great did a show on Monday that released, and he's out in LA, and he cried for the whole 30 minutes of his show. So, like, if y'all want to go back and listen, go to the website and listen to the Monday show for Baylor the Great on BTG for President. It's, you know, it's acts. And those acts, I'm hoping, will be able to live
on. Will inspire. And I think that it should inspire some other young men to take a different path, you know. He actually had a meeting with the police scheduled for today. Isn't that crazy?
Well, yesterday. It was supposed to be Monday.
Yeah. Right. That's crazy.
And like Jay-Z or something. It was like some crazy cast that was going to be there too. It wasn't just it wasn't just a police chief.
But it was led by him.
Right.
Yeah, it's just hard to process, you know, the pain and just the loss. But a lot of times people that are that way, they die and their death has more, you know, it gets the word out and the message out sometimes more than their life. So you know, difficult to deal with.
Yeah, definitely tough. Definitely tough.
I think that, you know, part of, it's hard to do that, but I think there is a there's, and I can't imagine, you know, my heart goes out to Lauren London. We just celebrate, you know, girlfriends and I were sitting around looking at their GQ spread they did a little while ago. Because I thought it was just really forward, just really, really progressive the way that they showcased the two of them. And I don't think we've seen couples. It just was a really cool way of doing it. The art direction was great.
Right.
There was a video interview of the two of them talking back and forth, and you could tell by Lauren's energy and the glow on her that she was just really happy, and they were so well suited and compatible. You know, and she'd been in some other relationships where it was a very different Lauren. You know, that you see. So I think that there is also value that we don't always acknowledge in compatibility and finding a partner that supports and loves you, you know, when you have a mission. And we all have a mission, but I think that their relationship, you know, allowed both of them to shine. And she was so supportive of him and he was so proud of her. It was just beautiful to see the two of them together, you know. Yeah. And like I said, my heart breaks for her, but I hope that it also continues the conversation that I try to really push on, just black love and how important that is for us. Because if you're doing something alone, that can be difficult, you know. But if you have a life partner that is compatible, that is, you know, has your back, it can make things a lot more bearable. And I think their relationship is a testament to, you know, to that.
I want to talk about one thing before we move on, though, because me and Kevin were kind of having an argument before you got here. Not an argument. It was a discussion. Mm-hmm. Kevin was saying that he was glad that Dr. Sabi's name came up. You want to kind of talk about that? And I can tell you why I feel like it's dangerous.
Well, I know that from Nipsey's Breakfast Club interview, he spoke about the documentary he was working on, and in specific, as I understand, it was not Dr. Sabi as a whole, but his trial with the state of New York when he put ads in the newspaper. Well, Dr. Sabi put ads in the newspaper saying that he cures AIDS and, you know, other diseases, right? And so he was sued by that because said, you can't have that claim, da-da-da. So he had to go into court to prove that, you know, what he was doing. Mm-hmm. And that's what as I understand, the documentary is about that specific case.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Right? Now, I don't know the content of the documentary. Mm-hmm. right? However, Dr. Sabi is someone who is seen not only as a healer, but as a, do I want to say a rebel against the pharmaceutical machine? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so he was championed. He was
FDA also
favorited, mm-hmm. right? And he had a lot of celebrity endorsements, mm-hmm. so on and so forth.
A lot.
So yeah, a lot of people came, would speak to his mm-hmm. work and say that, you know, he was the thing.
Yeah, we know Lisa Left Eye Lopez, yep. was a big, big supporter, and before she passed away, was, you know, involved with his movement and, yeah. and a big champion of it.
And so I think Nipsey's motivation for not only trying to give that story a platform was also trying to simultaneously share the ideas of Dr. Sabi, right. and the benefits. It was like Nabi was by taking up this story, Nipsey was also following in Dr. Sabi's footsteps or trying to push forth that message against such a large machine,
right.
almost similar to how Will Smith did with the movie against the NFL.
Uh-huh.
Right.
Uh-huh.
Right? And in Black culture, we like underdogs. We like rebels against the machine. Mm-hmm. We like the good bad boy.
Yeah.
Right? Mm-hmm. And this was all of that in a positive way. So
that's beautiful.
It's a story a lot of people grasped onto.
That's yeah. beautiful what you just said. I don't think I was going to argue against that. I thought maybe we were talking about something else because we didn't get into the discussion. And I know we got to rush, Crystal. So I'm going to say my side really quickly. What I felt was dangerous was everybody coming up with the conspiracy theory ideas and all the ideas yeah. about how this, what was really going on. Mm-hmm. Why that's dangerous is because it plays almost back into that victim role where Black people are victims and they're not willing to be or hold anyone accountable. This dude, whoever he is, needs to be held accountable. Mm-hmm. I don't want to blame it on the shadow government or the boogeyman. I want this dude because no matter who paid, let's say he did get paid off by somebody. Let's say it was a conspiracy. He still had to make a decision to kill his brother.
Yeah.
He still had to make a decision
True.
To devalue Nipsey's life and his dreams and aspirations to whatever it was that he got in return, if that's the case. Uh-huh. Or it was just some jealous nigga shit.
Yeah. And see,
that's why it's dangerous, because the conspiracy yeah. theory thing.
I agree with that, but I think I don't know where the balance is.
Well, Nipsey's a hero. Your hero doesn't die drunk in the bathroom.
Well, it wasn't drunk in the bathroom. It was at the hands of a jealous old friend. You know what I mean? But I think that my problem with a lot of us is that we are ignorantly just trying to take blame off of ourselves. And it does Right. make you a victim when you're constantly, oh, this was a setup from the government. They killed Dr. Sabi. They killed Tupac. No, and they killed
Dr. Sabi was old as fuck. Can we just... Nobody murdered him. I know that they wanted... He was older than a motherfucker.
Yeah, but he was also healthier than a motherfucker.
Yeah, but 30-year-olds died.
I don't know what happened.
This nigga was old. This nigga was 80-something. I know I saw the Drop It Like It's Hot video. He was 82 bouncing on
but
him.
But you know what?
He was okay, bouncing? So,
matter of fact, I'm going to say this.
All the way down. Was
all the way down. Yeah.
No, he
yeah.
wasn't.
Yeah. No, yeah, he would drop on
82.
His knees.
Yeah, he
Why
was
he twerking?
And he had a newborn at 82.
To show he could do it.
He had a newborn.
But niggas die every day, man. 20, 30, 40.
That's true.
Niggas are having newborns in their 80s.
Well,
they're not doing that.
Okay.
What? But is that a good thing? Okay.
I'm not going to.
Let's don't do it. I don't do it. But I'm just saying, we have got to stop assuming.
Right.
Everything that happens, especially when it's us, and I'm going to read you guys something that was said. One of my friends and the executive director for the King Foundation put up a post today, and I just want to get Kevin's thought process on this, because I feel like we have got to take responsibility for our part in our demise, or we will never get ahead. If we're constantly blaming a white man who has removed his hands a long time ago from most of it, because you don't have to do much when we're doing it to ourselves. She says, if you want to honor Nipsey Hussle, stop supporting music that encourages murdering black men, murdering black men and disrespecting black women. And that got a lot of negative response. But I don't understand how it possibly can, because, you know, if we're going to talk about how it's cool for us to hurt each other, right? Then when that happens and art imitates life, we can't then all of a sudden act like that narrative is no longer cool and it is the white man that caused us to do it. There are more African Americans now that own their own music. Nipsey Hussle actually owned his masters. So this mysterious white man that was making all of us do this gangster music and the music that was disrespecting our women, according to us, black people never wanted to do that. We were told we had to do it by the labels, even though that's not really the story that you will get if you watch the NWA and all. There's no white man that's behind Eazy-E saying you can only rap about this, but maybe there was a long time ago, but definitely
his name
now.
Was Jerry Heller, right?
But he wasn't saying that. He wasn't the white man in question.
I get what you're
saying. He was not giving him the content. He wouldn't have even known how to create that content.
And the argument is that, well, Arnold Schwarzenegger kills people in movies, but I don't think that movies and music are the same thing. Music, it gets to the soul.
Well, the first thing, our heroes are gladiators. They are the... In one way, they are the ones that are doing all of these deeds, right? Whether the guy is actually rapping about it or not. I mean, Common doesn't even, like, the nicest rapper that could be.
But Common's not saying that that you should kill. Art imitates life. And I just... Common is not.
I think life imitates art.
Well, right. That's why. Well, it's a cycle. I again, and you can look at her Instagram page. She says some really
because it's not like there aren't conscious
things.
Rappers out there. Y'all just don't support them.
Yeah. Well, I don't know about as y'all. I think it's not cool to do, and so I think that they are doing their work, but no one is making the other guys rap about things that are not. There's
well,
no white
you
man
make
saying
stuff
do
cool.
It.
Black women, y'all buy the most. Y'all set the trends. You spend the highest. You're paid well. Y'all do it.
It's
black
all,
women put
we,
some conscious
we,
rappers on.
We are the kings of the community. Another thing, Angela says, you've destroyed our communities with the words in your music. You've spoken death and destruction over our youth, not knowing how much power you have in your tongue.
Good.
Thoughts, concerns.
I think that's fair.
It's fair, yeah.
I think that's definitely fair. The art and the art, it's tough to say that the music is, you know, why people do things, but I mean, because especially when I'm also looking at people playing, I think more people are playing Call of Duty and stuff like that before doing mass shootings. I mean, this last
but it's different.
Especially this last mass shooting, the guy went live.
Right.
And yeah, if you watch the video, I swear to God, it looks exactly like that fucking video
that's
game.
That's because those video games are meant to look like how it would look if you were doing it.
Yeah.
So, but I think that...
They're very dangerous, but
there's a difference in video games and movies.
But if you don't want those images in your head...
But this is my problem, though. This is my problem. If I'm talking to you about music... It seems like in our community, and I hope we're talking to mostly us, we don't take accountability. We always want to, well, what about this? Nigga, I'm talking to you. And I think as a parent, we all know if I'm getting on my son about something, and his defense is not, I didn't do it. It's, but what about my sister? I don't care about her right now because I'm not talking to her. I'm talking to you. So if we're saying the music is a problem, there are more teenagers listening to music than doing anything because music it speaks to your spirit and your soul.
Sneaky.
It's
sneaky.
Very different.
It gets inside.
I don't care about I'm talking about the music. Now, I'm not saying that video
music
games are not
emotion.
Dangerous. I'm not saying that movies may not be dangerous. But right now, what I'm saying is that the heroes in our community... The people that set the cool is not the Call of Duty move. It's the video games. It's the rappers. It's the music. That's what dictates the culture. It shapes culture. We realize hip-hop culture shapes, hell, fashion and everything. So I don't understand why we're unable. When I say, you know what? I think it's horrible that white officers come in black communities and kill black men. I have a black son. I am very concerned about that. However, the likelihood of my son being killed by a cop is much less than him being killed by a man that looks like him.
And then you're
and that's
a coon.
Real.
And then you're a coon.
And then I'm wrong for saying that. Right. And then we say that there's no such thing as black on black crime. Yes, there is. I go back to what I always say. It is within the community that we should worry about the white folks. But when you pick it only when a white person kills one of you and when a black person kills one of you, we don't even care. We don't even care if the police solve the crime. How can we say we are pro-black? You're not pro-black. You only want to get upset when a white person does something. And you know what? That means white people think we're foolish. And they do. And I don't blame them. Because a billion Chicago teens can get killed by each other. The second a white cop does something, all of a sudden we want to rally and stand. Rally and stand and stop that from happening in your own community. It's embarrassing.
I agree with you, but I mean it's the same example that you just gave a moment ago. I am thoroughly disgusted with niggas in a fake gang bullshit. Like it's not a cool thing to do. It's not a way to live life. And especially at this age, I'm a little bit more mature, so I'm more willing to stand on it rather than when I was 20 years old and I'd look lame.
Right?
But when a white cop shoots a black unarmed kid, I am talking to you. I'm not asking you about all the shit that we do. I'm asking you about the shit that you did, Mr. White Cop. I want to know, I'm talking to you about your shit. Don't ask me about what happened in Chicago. Don't ask me about why there's gangs. We're not talking about that. We're talking about why white police officers can shoot little black boys and get away with the shit and get paid leave or just transfer districts and keep their fucking careers.
A lot of black boys kill black boys and get away with it. And everything is cool. The only reason
I don't know that little black boys get away with it. I know little black boys end up in prison quick as shit.
No, they don't.
Yes, they do.
First of all, most murders against black boys are not even they're not even solved. No one even cares. The only reason this boy is in jail now is because it was Nipsey Hussle and it became a national thing. If it was a random dude, how many young men between 18 and 30 do you think die in LA every day?
I don't know those stats.
Well, that's mighty convenient because I bet you if we're talking about how many cops killed, all of a sudden we want to get upset. More young men die at the hands of each other, and we don't give a damn. That's my problem.
There's not one white cop killing a black kid every day.
No, but there is definitely, and I'm not saying that the white cops aren't wrong, but what I am saying is that common sense tells me I need to fix the problem. If my son killed my daughter, I'm much more angry than if an outsider did it.
Well, here's how we fix the problem, in my opinion.
I am listening. I'm ready.
Firstly, what you and I do, black man and black woman, we have to get along because we're too busy fighting each other to recognize that the enemy is coming toward us.
We're the enemy.
We are the enemy.
But that's what she's saying is that we're also the enemy.
We are our own enemy. And I'm not saying it wasn't set up that way.
No, we have our differences. But black woman, you are not my enemy. We may not agree, but you're not my enemy. First and foremost, I am of you, black woman.
Well, yeah, but I mean...
Black man. As a black man, I'm saying, I am of you. You are not my enemy. Until you and I understand that first, I can't deal with all the white cops and the redlining and police brutality and injustices and hospital. I can't deal with all of that because I'm too busy fighting with you. When you and I get along first, that's when we can deal with all of the other shit.
We've gone on about our way, and we're doing really well with our black girl magic. You guys are fighting each other.
You're not doing that well. You're fighting with each other. You're unhappy. You're not fulfilled. You're looking for mates.
No, not all of us are. Did you guys know that I just received a position as investment relations director for a new company? We're doing great.
Congratulations.
Thank Fantastic.
You. Thank
do
you.
We, yeah. Do we have, do we, I know that there's probably a lot more we could talk about.
But
on
we,
that,
we,
but
we gotta,
have,
we gotta,
do we
go
have
into,
time for the next segment? Or?
Yeah, we got about,
all right,
we got about 10 minutes.
Okay.
To do that. So with that relationship plea from Mr. Kevin,
let's see how good we're going to do on these.
Let's see. So we had Terry Duran is a, and I'm so sorry, Terry, that you are in this segment after all this very emotional banter, but this is what black intellectuals do.
Right.
Terry is a very dope relationship expert. I asked him to be a part of today's show because he actually gives relationship advice from a male's perspective, right?
Uh-oh.
I know. I think we're friends. I'm not sure how this is going to turn out after his response. But I think that I appreciate Terry. We do a column to call Relation Tips for Rolling Out that comes out on Fridays. We answer a question from a male and a female perspective. And I think it's important. What he does is important because a lot of men will tell women what they want to hear. Right? And I don't think that actually moves us towards...
Even to the bed. It moves you to the bed.
It moves us to the bed, but it doesn't move us towards resolution. But Terry is very good at pissing women off because he does not tell them what they want to hear. He gives them a real man's perspective. So we've definitely got to have him on. But today we have him participating in three questions, okay, right? So I wanted to see, because I wanted to see if you all were going to agree with Terry, because he claims... Terry has something that he talks about on his page called a quality men versus fuck boys, right? So he says a quality man is going to have these type of responses.
Uh-oh.
And then
if we don't answer like him, we're fuck boys.
It could possibly
be that way. You could be a
fuck
boy too then today.
No, because I'm a woman, so I can't.
You're
I can't.
A fuck boy.
No.
My bet is you're going to be the fuck boy.
Oh my God. Okay. So the first question is, now I'm interviewing Pastor John Gray and his wife. I don't know if you guys know the hype going on about this. It's a pastor,
he cheated on her.
Very, very, very popular pastor. He cheated, but he claims the affair was emotional, not physical.
The devil made him do it.
Well, the devil did make him do it. According to his wife, the female was the devil that made him do it. But so my first
devil
question
in a blue dress.
Is, are emotional affairs, Which affair is more is a bigger threat to a relationship? An emotional affair or a physical affair? Emotional affair or a physical affair? I'll go ahead and say what I think.
Okay.
I think that an emotional affair is more detrimental to a relationship. I would rather my guy have a one-night stand with a woman than be in an emotional long-term relationship with her, even though they have not had sex, where he's talking to her, she's making him laugh, he's making her laugh, he may be paying a bill or helping her out, getting to know her. I feel like emotional connections are far deeper than physical connections. Gauntlet down.
So that's for a guy. But if it's a girl, there's a little different, there's a different mechanics that happens.
Okay.
Like, I don't want no porno star, no porn dick
right
in my girl. I'm sorry. Right. You know what I'm saying? We regular over here. It's regular shit. And it's still emotional. I'm just playing. It's still emotional because the physical stuff, I mean, the flesh is weak, man.
You can get over that.
This temptation is a motherfucker. If you put yourself in temptation's way, you'll probably lose. But emotional though, like when there are ties that have to do with, you know, when you're just sitting up somewhere thinking about them.
Mm-hmm.
Like, maybe even by me. You're near me thinking about them. Like,
yeah.
Wow, that's sometimes you can't come back from the emotional side. The physical side, you know, whatever it was, maybe just the feel good of right now. But the emotional thing is something that I think carries over.
Yeah, I agree. Emotional is in one way, it's detaching yourself spiritually from your mate.
Yeah.
And your... already like this sowing the seed of this new relationship. So you like mentally you've checked out.
You guys are actually like real.
We're not fuckboys.
Oh wow.
We're not
I'm impressed. All right, let's see what Terry says.
What's going on, everybody? I'm Terry Duran and I'm responding to the question, what's more damaging to a relationship? An emotional affair or a physical one? So let's start with both. Any type of affair has the potential to damage or kill a relationship. because an affair, if it's discovered, essentially kills the trust in a relationship. And that's what typically drives a wedge between a couple and ends a relationship. But in regard to the question, I think a physical affair is more damaging because there are more potential repercussions. You can't get pregnant from an emotional affair. It's really predicated on thoughts and feelings as opposed to the physical nature of an affair, which is a large part of the problem that people seem to overcome. Even though the physical aspect can be limited, it could be one blowjob, it could be one sexual encounter. The potential for not only the physical problems, you could get caught, there's more evidence, you could be seen by other people, you could potentially catch an STD or get pregnant. In addition to all of those physical problems, you're still going to have to deal with the emotional aspect of the cheating, the lack of trust, the questioning everything that you did and why you did it, how you felt about the other person, etc. So the physical, if somebody that physically cheated got caught, I think they're going to have a much bigger hurdle to overcome in order to repair the relationship than a person that was just flirting or sending texts or something to that nature where they can prove or verify that they never had any sexual encounter at all. That person has a lot better chance of salvaging their relationship. So in regard to the question, I'd say that a physical affair is much more damaging than an emotional one, even though both have the potential to end a relationship.
Wow. I didn't expect that. I didn't. It's funny because I did hear, I was talking to one of my mentors earlier, and he said that. He said, well, there are statistics that show one night stands, people are less likely to use protection. So a lot of pregnancies and STDs.
I don't use protection.
You've said that before.
It's not going to happen. If I cheat, you know it was raw dog.
Oh, my God. Okay.
Hey, but you know what? That was a tough question, though. I mean, it was like, but that's true. What's better, a rock or a hard place?
It is. But he said that cheating is always bad. I do think that for women, emotional is hard. But the idea of you seeing your significant other, you picturing them having sex with someone can be maddening. So, you know, good perspective. So the next question, now this is what's going to separate the quality men from the fuck boys. All right.
Ooh, I ain't been this nervous since the Steve Harvey book.
You got to love Mr. Kevin. But all right. Which is more important, compatibility or chemistry? That this hurts me. Can I tell you guys how much this hurts my soul? Because I really like chemistry, right? So I think like chemistry is like, I really like it. I like to be attracted to the person. I like them to be very attracted to me. But I think the older I get, I'm starting to really feel that compatibility is more important because chemistry can be something that dies down. Like you could have like really great physical chemistry or you could be really attracted to a person, but after year four, that may not matter as much. I really hate this though, because I wish chemistry was more important, but I'm just, the older I get, I'm starting to have to admit.
I disagree with you.
Really?
I do. I think chemistry is far more important because, for instance, me and my wife are best friends. Mm-hmm. Because we're best friends, the rest of that shit don't matter a lot of times. When we get in an argument, something play where a square don't fit a circle in our argument, because we're best friends, it doesn't really matter. We'll figure it out. So I think chemistry to me is far more important than compatibility. Because you can't be compatible with everything about somebody. You know what I'm saying? I may not like ketchup on my cheeseburger, but you like ketchup. That's not really compatible, but it doesn't matter. We're much better friends than ketchup could break up. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So I think the chemistry is more important because of that.
I guess. I mean, I guess it's a blurry line because I feel like chemistry is important in it. Chemistry is a piece of compatibility. We don't have to have the same favorite color. You know what I'm saying? We don't have to both like chicken.
Chicken and watermelon.
Right. Like I don't think that's what makes you compatible. Rather than I think what does make you compatible is an understanding of who each other are and where they come from. You know, things that they've dealt
with. So you're blurring this line. What are you saying? Yeah, which one?
That's why I said it's a blurry line.
Which one, FB?
I'm torn to choose between chemistry and compatibility.
You must choose.
Just pick one. Come on.
Okay.
Man.
Compatibility.
All right. Let's see what the doc says. He's not a doc, is he?
No, he's an expert.
What's more important, compatibility or chemistry? In my opinion, I think compatibility is much more important than chemistry. Chemistry is usually predicated on superficial things or things that don't really lead to relationship success. Your level of physical attraction to someone else, your flirtation with them, your similar taste in music or style or doing an event. Like, those are the type of things that chemistry is built on. And none of those things are the things that make a relationship last long term, and they don't represent the things that make a relationship a healthy relationship. Compatibility is much more important, because if you're compatible with something, that means you work well together. If a certain type of device is compatible with another type of device, that means that they can work together and both devices can do what they need to do. If something is incompatible, that means it does not function properly. If I want to order some software and it says it's not compatible with an Apple computer, that means it's not going to do nothing that it's supposed to do if I try to install it on my computer. So in relationship terms, if you are not compatible with someone on several fronts, parenting, finances, communication, ambition, like all the things that really matter in a relationship, problem resolution, things like that, then you're not going to be able to overcome the obstacles that come in normal life, that occur when you are raising a family, that occur when you're dealing, when you lose a job, when something unexpected happens. And so if you're actually compatible with someone where y'all are compatible on the things that really matter, your life goals are very similar or close enough that you can compromise. Because compromising is a major part of a relationship. And in order to make a compromise that is going to work for two people, you have to be close in areas. You can't be drastically apart and then just really realistically expect to meet in the middle on everything. That's not going to be a sustainable relationship. So if you're compatible with somebody on several fronts, the things that y'all disagree on, it's a lot easier to come up with compromises on those couple of things, as opposed to being in a relationship where y'all got in a committed relationship based off how good the sex was or chemistry or something that's superficial that does not lead to relationship success. That's how a lot of people end up in marriages or having kids by people that they really don't get along with, and they end up hating or resenting long term. So in my opinion, I think compatibility is much more important than chemistry when it comes to relationship success or having or establishing or maintaining a healthy relationship.
Man, I am 0-2 on this expert.
Oh, well, hey, this is awesome for me. Now, this one, I'm almost afraid. I almost think we should maybe wait and use this one for the next show.
Oh, no. Seriously? It's like a whole topic?
I mean, no, it goes in with what we're saying.
It must be about sex.
No, it's not. We can definitely
should
do that
you use
show.
Your new vagina?
Right.
No, you
of course
shouldn't.
I want to wait.
You should wait. He actually said that men do not like celibacy. So if you're...
Well, who likes celibacy? Women don't like celibacy.
Tell a man that you not... But he said that there's no way... Basically, he was telling one of the... There was like a Steve Harvey clip where the lady was like, I've been celibate for 6 years. How can I get a man? And Steve was like, I don't know. You're going to have to go find one in a church or something. And even then, it's going to be rough.
You know who really hates celibacy? Hmm. New vaginas.
Anyway, so the question is, who benefits more from marriage, men or women?
Women.
Obviously, it's men.
Definitely. Are you kidding?
What? It's men.
Okay, here's the thing.
Would you like me to share with you? Go
please.
Ahead.
No,
you
please.
Go first.
No, you go first.
No, please.
No.
You go first.
I tell you, when you get a divorce, you figure out immediately who benefits more from it.
Well, in my divorce, my ex-husband benefited more.
So then you need to talk to your attorney.
I didn't. I did not. Yeah. Yeah, but you.
Your attorney shafted you. Because you had it all, girl. And you let it all go.
I don't know if this is the forum to go talking from your wounds. It's... keep it okay.
Well, no, this is why I say that men benefit more. Because we don't live in a time period where women don't work, right? We work in, we live in a time that both sexes, most marriages, both sexes go to work, right? However, in my understanding, women are expected to not only do the same thing a man does as far as go to work.
But all the old shit too.
But also all the old shit as well. And I'm just trying to figure out. So I remember thinking to myself like, okay, I work a lot, you know, probably more than most people. And then I have to take care of my kids. And then I have to take care of the house. And sometimes all of that becomes overwhelming. If I throw a man in here, it's just more work. I'm not.
You got another kid.
I do. I'm not getting. I remember going out with this guy and he was like telling me that I needed to start coming to his games because he was a basketball coach. And I started to hyperventilate because I was just like, I don't have any more time.
You tell him, fuck your games?
I can't take any more. I cannot take any more burdens. And I know that means he's going to want somebody to clean up after him. He's going to want more food.
And then you got
to
fucking cheer at a basketball game too?
Cheer at a basketball game and have the energy.
He got an 0-20 record.
To be
you still
Jenna
got
Jameson
a cheer.
In the bedroom at night. And it's,
you just
did she pick
know.
A white porno star?
No. You just shouldn't have been dating.
No, I should have been dating.
You didn't have time in your life to dedicate to somebody
not true.
Else.
I'm just saying. I'm just saying it's going to be a lot of work.
We should have held this one. I think Kevin is about to come off the ring ropes on you.
Maybe we should hang on till because we've got it. We
always say
I'm
beating up on Crystal.
He's about to come the third turnbuckle.
No, let's table it till next week because I've definitely got to go and this is going to take more.
Mm-hmm.
So you all can send in your answers.
Right.
We'll save Terry's response and then we'll talk about this. And I don't mean this in a bad way. I think marriage is great, but I think it presents a lot more work for women unless you are with a very wealthy man.
But that wasn't the question. Read the question again so people who are writing in can or calling in or whatever.
Okay.
Can
Let give me
us
give
their
you guys
cuz you changed
opinion.
The question.
Let's do a poll. Let's do a poll.
Can you
before.
Put the number at the bottom so they call and leave their voicemails?
I will.
Yeah.
Okay, hold on. Okay. Who benefits more from marriage, men or women?
Okay.
It's simple. Who benefits more? Do women benefit more or do men? Please explain. Let's put it on the page, on the Facebook page.
Okay.
And then we'll see whatever, and we'll be able to read some of the people's responses next week.
678-636-9116 is the voicemail number, or you can put a voice memo and email it to music@musiclovelifeshow.com. Either way.
I can't wait. Ladies, please don't let me down. Don't let me down. Share your stories of how you're working 9 to 5, coming home, cleaning, cooking, sexing, putting kids, doing
y'all
homework.
Y'all not even coming home. More men cook, but see, this is how we go.
That's what I'm saying.
Let's do it.
So
let's do
is,
it. I'm bringing my arsenal.
Let me go.
Y'all have my back, ladies. Mm-hmm. Have my back. When we're going to do Facebook. We'll have to do Facebook after. We'll do a Facebook Live after this one.
Before we leave, I want to give a shout out to Dino Red from the Shiznit Show. They just had their 200th episode on Sunday. I was on the show.
Awesome.
And he says that, well, actually his whole cast say that we're his favorite show on the whole network. So shout out to them for 200th episode. Check out the Shiznit Show if you haven't. He's somebody I've known since I started podcasting. He's a cool dude. So
I want to go on their show and talk. I want to share. That's so awesome. They like us. They really like us.
You might be his least favorite one of them.
Really?
I don't know. I'm just saying that.
Don't say that. I don't believe that.
Finish the lies.
I don't believe
that.
You want the fluffy.
Leave
the
lies.
Let's put it on his page. Does he have a Facebook page?
He does.
Okay, I'll ask.
Your favorite. You're his favorite, excuse me.
You're his favorite.
I'm going to ask because I want to be his favorite.
Okay. Like, share, and subscribe, right?
He knows what's good for him.